Hello, and welcome to this third part of the lecture series on psychosis. This is Dr. Nicholas Hatcher, and in this presentation, we will examine the influence of stress and environmental factors and their role in the pathogenesis of psychosis. Here is a reminder of where we are in the series following our outline. At this point, we have discussed how various factors predispose an individual to psychosis. Following a stress diathesis model, we will now turn our attention to what role stressors play in this equation. Stress is a perceived or actual imbalance between internal or external supply and demand. Supply refers to internal and external resources. Some of these include level of resilience, coping skills, material assets, and social support, among other things. Demand is an encounter that leads to actual or perceived challenge, threat, or loss. This can occur in a variety of circumstances, as you could imagine, some of which include environmental events, social changes, transitions, intrapsychic conflict, and changes in attention and awareness, among other things. An evaluative process known as appraisal is used to weigh the demand, which is primary appraisal, and supply, which is secondary appraisal. When the demand outweighs the supply, the encounter is considered a stressor. Because stress requires an associated meaning attached to a stressor, it is therefore meaning that contributes to the derangement specifically. This becomes important in the context of psychosis because the meanings that psychotic individuals give to ordinary daily events immerse their brains in severe or toxic stress, where normal life then becomes a persistent source of stress. Here I've listed some key stressors implicated in psychosis. While not an all-inclusive list, some implicated stressors include sexual and physical abuse, neglect, double binding, pseudo-mutuality, distressed family functioning, parental death, bullying, poverty, foster home placement, immigration, urbanization, and parental separation in the first year of life. Let me clarify a few concepts on this list. Double binding is a dilemma in which an individual receives two or more conflicting messages. This may be seen in situations of abuse, among other things, where there is a message of love and affection, but at the same time there is physical, sexual, or emotional abuse. Pseudo-mutuality is a relationship in which surface harmony and agreement cloaks deep and damaging interpersonal conflict. Stressful adverse life experiences sculpt the structure of the brain and alter the epigenetic expression of genes that regulate neural pathways. There are notable effects in the hippocampus, which include atrophic changes, among other alterations, the amygdala, hypertrophy, among other changes, and the prefrontal cortex, atrophy, among other changes. Adverse events in childhood can result in long-lasting stress-mediated damage to the brain that has an impact extending beyond childhood into interpersonal relationships in adult life. These observations about the lasting effects of childhood trauma affirm what psychoanalysts have long known, that is, that childhood experiences shape development and leave an enduring imprint on the mind. They influence the construction of mental representations that children form of themselves and others. These early templates shape subsequent interpersonal relationships and the meanings that adults assign to their life events. Normally, stress is recognized by the paraventricular nucleus, or PVN, of the hypothalamus. This results in the release of corticotropin-releasing hormone, or CRH, which stimulates the anterior pituitary to release adrenocorticotropic hormone, or ACTH, which stimulates the adrenal gland to synthesize and release cortisol. Cortisol is our stress hormone and functions to mobilize energy sources and mitigate the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems in an adaptive response to stress. Cortisol feeds back onto the hypothalamus, anterior pituitary, adrenal gland, and hippocampus in order to let the system know that there has been an adequate concentration of cortisol to support the body under stress. The hippocampus assists in memorizing this response so that in the future, the stress response can be initiated or stopped based on the stressor. Repeated or severe stress, however, results in hypothalamic pituitary adrenal, or HPA, hyperactivity. This contributes to an increase in basal cortisol levels and impaired responsiveness to further stress. There is blunting of the normal inhibitory feedback mechanisms of the HPA axis. Increased cortisol contributes to an upregulation in dopamine and glutamate synthesis. Both of these neurochemicals, as discussed in a previous lecture, are strongly implicated in psychotic symptoms. Not all stress is bad. Dr. Robert Sapolsky emphasizes the nonlinear nature of stress through his conceptualization of the inverted U. This serves as a function of stressor severity. In this model, stress is divided into mild, moderate, and severe stress. Mild or good stress can occur in a setting that is felt to be fundamentally safe, where stress is transient and facilitates alertness, arousal, engagement, learning, stimulation, and play. Moderate or tolerable stress remains within an individual's coping capacity. Mild to moderate stress is reflected in the left side of the curve. Severe or toxic stress has a high impact, is frequent and/or continuous, burdening the organism with a load of stress that cannot be processed and dissipated. Severe or toxic stress is reflected in the right side of the curve. Some of the aforementioned examples, such as sexual and physical abuse, emotional neglect, and bullying, are all examples of severe stress that can increase the risk for psychosis. The point of transition between mild, moderate, and severe stress is under debate, but is likely highly influenced by the meaning attached to a stressor. The curve is likely shifted to the left, where there is increased vulnerability to stress, due to underlying predisposing factors or vulnerabilities, as an example, a pre-existing disconnectivity syndrome. The curve may be shifted to the right, where there's increased resilience, in the setting of a more supportive environment and targeted interventions to promote coping skills. The presence of a supportive environment can offset underlying vulnerabilities. There is a dynamic interplay of genetic predisposition and environmental factors. A positive rearing environment can protect a high-risk individual against future development of enduring psychotic illness. On the other hand, without genetic predisposition, even a highly dysfunctional family situation will not produce enduring psychotic illness. The combination of genetic risk and a dysfunctional environment, however, places an individual at high risk for developing an enduring psychotic illness. Put simply, genes control the degree to which an individual is sensitive to the environment's predisposing or risk-increasing aspects versus risk-reducing and protective aspects. It is important to note that while the stress diathesis model reflects the pathogenesis of enduring psychotic illness, there are some nuances to consider. First, stress can be a diathesis in and of itself. Also, this model can be bypassed by some circumstances such as substance use, medication side effect, and certain medical illnesses. This will be discussed in a little more detail later, but as an example, the psychosis generated from acute intoxication from hallucinogens, for instance, does not imply that there is necessarily underlying neurobiological disconnectivity with onset during perinatal and childhood development. These types of stressors provide a significant enough alteration in the neurochemical environment to bypass normal homeostatic mechanisms. By nature, however, these forms of psychosis are more likely transient and reversible with correction of the underlying cause. For downloadable content such as written notes, PowerPoint slides, and more related to this lecture series, please visit my website using the link below. You can also support my goal of continuing to provide new content through Patreon, where becoming a patron will provide you with access to downloadable content as I create new content. Thank you for your support. Here are my references for this presentation. Thank you for listening.